We thank you for joining us here on WMKV and WLHS. We're jumping in on Russ Helpman's time here for a little bit because we have some more news about the Cincinnati Contemporary Jazz Orchestra. Earlier this week, we actually were discussing a special program with Mandy Gaines and Eric Lechleiter. Today, we have two more guests here in the studio with us, and we have Phil DeGreg and Rick VanMatre. We're talking today about the Jazz at First series with the Cincinnati Contemporary Jazz Orchestra. This happens at First Unitarian Church. It's coming up this Sunday, October 24th. It's at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The church is located at 536 Linton Street, and you can get tickets at cincinnatijazz.org. We'll give that information throughout the show. Phil, Rick, thank you for coming in here with us.
Thanks for inviting me.
Great to be here.
We are here with two more of the Cincinnati Jazz Hall of Famers, which I always love. Wonderful musicians come in here. I also want to thank both of you for all that you have done, not only in performing live music all through Cincinnati, but both of you, longtime educators with CCM. So thank you for churning out new generations of these incredible musicians and keeping Cincinnati on the jazz map.
Thank you.
Thanks. Well, as I was saying to you before we went on the air, I want to recognize you for being a legend in the broadcasting world and all you've done for promoting jazz in that way.
Well, mine's very small compared to what you guys have done. We're talking today about the special program coming up Sunday, October 24th. It's called Time Out. Rick VanMatre Plays Brubeck. We're going to be hearing the music of Dave Brubeck at the First Unitarian Church. The Phil DeGreg Trio with saxophonist Rick VanMatre. In fact, Rick, you have been called a sax titan that I saw in one of the reviews.
Well, we don't need to think about those PR things right now.
Phil, you have your trio with you, which includes, of course, you on piano, Aaron Jacobs on bass, and John Taylor on drums. This is a very intimate and beautiful sounding venue, the First Unitarian Church. What does that feel like to all of you? I know Phil and I have talked about this before, but Rick, when you play in a place that's not a club, something like this, you're playing in a church, basically, what does it feel like to you?
Yeah, well, there's two points to that. One is, like you say, it's not a club, so there's a certain concert feel to it, but it's not like a big auditorium concert. It's a more intimate, but you sort of feel like there's the mood of that or the rapt attention of the audience. And then the second part is the acoustics, that you can do it without amplification, which is always a joy.
With Cincinnati musicians, everybody plays with somebody else at one point or another. Any idea how many performances you two may have partaken in together?
We did a lot at the university, for sure.
Sure. And again, the First Unitarian Church, I know, Phil, we spoke about this a little while back, but it is a beautiful venue, and it's just warm and very, very intimate. Is that correct?
Yeah, and it sounds particularly great. Every wind instrument player that's ever played in there, they'd like to just take that place home in their back pocket because their instruments just, it amplifies them so beautifully.
The featured music will be that of Dave Brubeck. This is also dedicated to the memory of Mike Andres, and we'll talk a little bit more about Mike Andres later. In fact, looking up some of the things, I think it was Mr. Broadway on Live at Carmelo's. He was obviously played lead alto sax on that, doing Brubeck. Let's talk for a moment about the music of Dave Brubeck. Everybody, I think, has heard Take Five, and I would venture a guess that you probably have heard at least a half dozen to dozens of other Brubeck tunes that you might not recognize as you would Take Five. Mm-hmm. What does Brubeck mean to each of you? How did he influence you as musicians?
I'll start. I mean, he was the first jazz pianist I was ever aware of. There was a copy around of Take Five. And he's sort of a gateway musician for a lot of, and for piano players too. That was such a popular record. And Brubeck was immensely popular, and therefore, you know, he seemed like he could reach so many different people. He never seemed esoteric. He seemed like very direct and melodic. And of course, he had Paul Desmond with him to make his music even better.
I guess you could say he was very accessible. That kind of cool jazz, it didn't get very obtuse ever, it seemed, as far as the arrangements and what he was writing. Rick, what's your take on Dave Brubeck?
Well, as a saxophonist, of course, one of the alto players you have to know about is Paul Desmond. So I was introduced to his music early on. And it's interesting because you talk about cool, and that, of course, struck me as I was listening to Coltrane or Sonny Rollins or all the other greats. I was trying to pull ideas and moods and ways of playing from all of them. But then, you know, you think of Desmond as a class unto himself on just super elegant, cool kind of sound. But Brubeck as a pianist, there were some other moments, especially later on, but there were times when he would freak out just a little bit and kind of fool you with things that you could hardly call cool.
Once again, this is a great opportunity for those people who obviously know the name Dave Brubeck to actually hear Rick VanMatre doing Paul Desmond and Phil DeGreg doing Dave Brubeck along with the trio. It's going to be absolutely fantastic. Again, Jazz at First. This is at First Unitarian Church, Sunday, October 24th. This coming Sunday, the concert is an afternoon concert, 2 o'clock. It's at 536 Linton Street. And again, we'll give the information about getting tickets, but it's as simple as going to cincinnatijazz.org. It's a great way to do this. Phil, you've already had one under your belt at the First Unitarian Church so far for this season. What was it like getting back to having that live audience?
Oh, it was great. People were very happy to be listening to music live. And everything about it was very uplifting. People were in a great mood.
I'll tell you what, why don't we play a little bit of Take Five? It's the one most people have heard, and you may not know it as Take Five. You may say, well, I'm not sure what Brubeck wrote. I don't know what he performed. 99% of you will probably know this song. Any kind of a setup you have for Take Five?
Well, actually, it was written by Paul Desmond. Unlike most of the things that Brubeck recorded.
Wow, okay, I learned something on the show.
Yeah, Paul Desmond wrote that, but it became Dave Brubeck's signature tune, especially because of the fact he was experimenting with playing in odd, what we call odd meters, instead of 4-4 time, four beats to the measures. This one was 5, and at the time, it was a pretty big deal.
It's ironic that the biggest hit that he had was Paul's composition, but everything else that we're playing and everything else that he's known for were Brubeck's own compositions.
That's right. Yeah.
That is fantastic. Let's hear a little bit of Take Five right now. Our special guest, Rick VanMatre and Phil DeGreg, the Jazz at First series coming up on Sunday, October 24th, this Sunday. Time out. Rick VanMatre plays Brubeck with Phil DeGreg and his trio. You can get more ticket information at cincinnatijazz.org. Here's some Take Five. Thank you. a segment of Take Five from Dave Brubeck, and I learned something. Paul Desmond wrote the song. I mean, you think of Brubeck performing so many things that you just assume that he wrote. So, again, that's what I love about doing these interviews, because I learned something every time we sit down. And we have Phil DeGreg here. His trio will be performing with Rick VanMatre, doing some great Dave Brubeck selections Sunday, October 24th, this Sunday. Brubeck, we talked about cool jazz, and I know I use that term, and Rick, you brought it up too. Who were some of the other people that were influenced by Dave Brubeck and Paul Desmond?
Well, certainly there's a whole, quote, West Coast school of playing that was influenced. But, you know, it's interesting. Like I said before, sometimes Brubeck would venture out into things that you might not so easily call cool. But also, in terms of Phil and I trying to interpret this music, that's always the dilemma for musicians. How do you put your own stamp on it, your personality? And of course, we would never want to just be imitators, Phil, of Brubeck, or myself of Desmond. But on the other hand, you're trying to pay some tribute to, and you're trying to keep some of the aesthetic, some of the mood. So, you know, how do you do that? And what's going too far away and maybe not so appropriate? But people just have to use their judgment to, you know, where were we on crossing that line?
Well, I'm going to tell you, with the trio and Rick VanMatre, you're going to love this. If you're a Dave Brubeck fan, or maybe you want to acclimate someone young in your life who may not have heard Dave Brubeck before, here's a great way to listen. What are some of the other selections people can expect to hear this Sunday?
Well, you mentioned Take Five and Blue Rondo a la Turk. We'll probably play The Duke, which was one of his best things, dedicated to Duke Ellington, that particular one. In Your Own Sweet Way, a lot of jazz musicians like to play it. It's not known by the public as much, I don't think. Might play the Trolley Song. I'm not sure. The Trolley Song was not his tune, but he made a very popular recording of that.
Strange Meadowlark.
Yeah, thank you. That's a really lovely tune that we can't leave off of it. It's got a lot of almost impressionistic, you know, Debussy-type harmony in it. Dave Brubeck, one thing that people should know is, I mean, as a composer, you were mentioning about the orchestral things that he did later in life. Well, even in these songs that we're playing, their compositional element of them is really strong. That's mainly why I'm interested in playing them anyway, is because they're just very challenging. They make a lot of sense musically to us, but when you look at them and take them apart a little bit, you're saying, well, there's a lot in this music, the compositional level.
We were talking before the show, something that I was aware of was that he has a tie to Cincinnati, Dave Brubeck does. Even though he was not Jewish, he wrote a piece, a very heavy, very introspective piece called Gates of Justice. And it was performed, actually, for the first time ever here in Cincinnati at Rockdale Temple in 1969. And then Rick reminded me that shortly after that, he converted to Catholicism after being somewhat of a non-religious person at all. So it's very interesting. But even within that pseudo-classical piece, there is room for improvisation.
Yes.
You could see that he added the jazz feel into something that would normally be a very tight, very formatted orchestration. There are places where solos are allowed, and it was just amazing to see that.
Yeah, I played that at one point, and I remember there was a lot of improvisational sections in that.
Speaking of the harmony, the sophistication of some of this, I just really have to give kudos to Phil for all the work that he's done in putting this together. I mean, I'm just the saxophonist but it's the guru of harmony and of transcribing all that's come before. Phil's just a master at that, and Phil's not just relying upon the sort of the textbook version, you know, he's dug into it and transcribed, and then, of course, he's put his own special personality into it harmonically. So it's a joy to be able to do that.
That's something I will never be able to fathom, how you even approach that, especially if you take something that might have been originally written as an orchestral piece. How do you pare that down into a quartet in this case?
Well, let me straighten this out.
Okay.
I haven't taken any orchestral pieces.
Okay.
I'm just saying Dave Brubeck is at heart a composer. And when he writes jazz pieces, if you look at them, there's a lot of elements which are not so obvious. And then you look at it, that make them compositionally really strong.
Our special guests here on WMKV and WLHS. We're breaking in on some of Russ's music time, but we have a chance to have Phil DeGreg and Rick VanMatre. They are going to be performing together Phil's trio, which includes John Taylor and Aaron Jacobs, and also Rick VanMatre on saxophone, the Jazz at First series. It's called Jazz at First because First Unitarian Church on Linton Street is the location. The next show, this one coming up, Time Out, Rick VanMatre plays Brubeck with the Phil DeGreg Trio, of course, but Sunday, October 24th, this Sunday, 2 o'clock, and tickets are available still. You can get them at cincinnatijazz.org. It is that easy to do it. Both of you have been educators a long time. Yeah. You both worked at CCM, taught at CCM, and we mentioned that at the beginning of the show. How did students take to something like Dave Brubeck?
Well, he's part of the history of the music, an important part. And so, I mean, I think they just consider him, they learn some of his music, just like many other people. There's so many great jazz pianists.
Sure.
He's just one of them as far as they're concerned, but and it's worth looking into.
He may be assimilated, though, into their style at some point where they say, wow, I'm playing Brubeck now or something like that. Rick, what about you?
Yeah, I think it does not matter what exact original style was. I mean, you should, as a student, you should study it exactly, really assimilate it as much as you can, but then you try to let go of that and let yourself come out. So I think all of the great students know that the masters like that are someone that they have to delve into deeply, but then when it comes time to their own playing, just like we were saying before, when Phil's going to improvise on these tunes or I'm going to, there'll be times where we kind of stay in that historical setting, but there are times that we'll stretch out, and especially a tune like Take Five that you just played, there's a thing that Phil does on that that's much different than Brubeck himself ever did, and he's using the complex meter there and harmonically shifting all around. So all these things can be a vehicle for your modern expression, no matter what they were exactly to begin with.
I mean, the important thing is that when we're playing, we're in the moment and we're listening intensely to each other. That's why people like to listen to live jazz, is
exactly.
Because they can experience that process, and it's something that you can't necessarily tell as well by just listening to a recording at all.
And every one of these, no matter where they hear you, no matter how many times they hear you, each one, I would say, is what the old phrase, a one-off. Because it's never the exact same anywhere. The only time you're going to hear something repeated the same way is off of a recording. But checking it out live, as we talked about, the exchanges between the musicians, and even with a quartet, I mean, we're not talking about a big band here, but a quartet, the exchanges and the creativity playing off of each other, and you guys with an incredible history of playing together at CCM and working with students, this is just going to be a wonderful afternoon. It's this Sunday, 2 o'clock, October 24th, the Jazz at First series, Time Out. Rick VanMatre plays Brubeck, and Time Out, just one of the songs, Take Five, we're going to hear. Phil and Rick just gave a number of other ones. I do want to mention that we just recently lost, Rick and I were talking about this before the show, a gentleman who played with so many different organizations, but especially was a longtime lead alto sax player with the Blue Wisp Big Band, which is near and dear to my heart because I started mixing them, my first ever mixing job. He was also a CCM instructor, as I recall, as well, Mike Andres. Tell us a little bit about Mike's life and why this is important to dedicate to him.
Not only was he a CCM instructor, I studied with him. I remember when I was in high school, I had the opportunity to hear him on performances and was inspired tremendously. Then I moved away from Cincinnati, and I was in Boston. Then I moved back to Cincinnati and studied with Mike at CCM. And so that was the second part of it, which I felt so lucky about. And then even more lucky later on, I got to play professionally sitting next to him. So just one of the most absolutely inspiring, outstanding, special musicians I've ever had the opportunity to be with in my life.
I know we just recently lost him, but he kind of retired, I guess it was, 3 or 4 years ago from playing on a regular basis due to illness. But Phil, Mike Andres, what are some of your recollections?
Well, most of my experiences with Mike have been with subbing with the Blue Wisp Band. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've been a substitute pianist. I've never actually, Steve has always done that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he's an impeccable player. You could tell when he was leading the sax section, it was really strong, and a lot of that had to do with him as the lead voice of that section.
And while we're talking about Mike Andres, if you want to hear him playing a solo on Brubeck music, I understand on Live at Carmelo's, Mr. Broadway, he's got a solo in there, so that's really cool. But we're all thinking of Mike Andres, and it's wonderful that you were paying tribute to his life and the contributions. He was 15 years at WLWT on things like the Bob Braun Show and things like that with the CSO and the Pops. And I know, Rick, you've played with the Pops as well. Phil, have you had a chance to?
Just a couple of times with the Pops.
Well, this is fantastic. Let's make sure we give the information again and anything you two would like to add. What would you say to somebody who's sitting on the fence and saying, I don't know what I'm doing this Sunday? 2 o'clock's rolling around, and I want to go see this. What is the reason people should be headed to the First Unitarian Church on Linton Street?
And they can get tickets right at the door. Mm-hmm. I mean, if they just want to come up there, they're selling them. I don't know. You go into an environment, and a lot of people just enjoying themselves listening to music, but nobody's going to distract you from the music. It's quiet. The church is quiet. And they have some free refreshments during the intermission, too.
Beautiful.
So,
well, again, the Cincinnati Contemporary Jazz Orchestra, I can't thank them enough for their support of WMKV. But we're very, very much into Cincinnati music. We love playing these artists. In fact, Rick just dropped off a CD that I don't know that we have in our system, so we're going to have to add some of that. We've got Phil in the system, but anything new you guys come up with, get it over here to us, and we'll get it on the air. But we want to remind you again, it's the Jazz at First series, First Unitarian Church, this Sunday, 2 o'clock. That's October 24th. The Phil DeGreg Trio, Rick VanMatre on saxophone as well, dedicated to the memory of Mike Andres. And it's going to be a wonderful afternoon of great music. And I want to thank both of you for, as I said, dropping that pebble in that pond and watching the wakes go out as you educate more and more students over the years. And I know you're both emeritus right now, but still very active with trying to teach and influence young performers and continuing the live music. We need more people like you to keep purveying this music live for us. So thank you both for being here today.
Well, thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks so much.
We're going to close out with some Blue Rondo a la Turk from Dave Brubeck. Thank you. Rondo a la Turk from Dave Brubeck. Once again, you can get tickets at cincinnatijazz.org. Sunday, October 24th, this Sunday, 2 o'clock, and tickets are available still. You can get them at cincinnatijazz.org. The Cincinnati Contemporary Jazz Orchestra, Jazz at First Series. It's the second show of their season. It's Time Out. Rick VanMatre.